Break-in started in Brooklyn, New York as an alternative to gang wars. Although the dancing started outside in the streets, in Selma they break street beat and moonwalk inside. Members of Rapmaster Crew range in age from 14 to 21. Each afternoon after work or school, they meet at a local nightclub whose owner contributes the turntables and dance floor until paying customers arrive in the evening. They are chaperoned by Skip Goodwin, who is employed by BBAC, the Black Belt Arts and Cultural Center in Selma, a local not-for-profit organization which encourages the arts, including dance.
Well, I've been with BBAC now about a year, and all these talented guys standing behind me decided to form this group and asked me to manage them. And I think they're the best. I think they can beat anybody in New York or any place else.
Rapmaster Crew break, pop, street beat, centipede, and scratch. All this is enough to put any needle in album and most bodies on the injured reserve list. But not Rapmaster Crew, because they have a message. And when they rap, that message speaks for itself.
That's the point we're trying to put across. Stay in school, get your lesson, and get a good education, you'll be like us.
All this rapping and dancing not only inspires confidence, it's also profitable. Rapmaster Crew appear in nightclubs across the state and charge $500 to $1,000 per evening. And they never forget who gave them their first break. 25% of their profits are given back to BBAC. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Selma. Store-bought peppers aren't spicy enough for Larry McGahee's sauce, so he grows his own peppers right here on his front porch. These plants came from seedlings taken from a jungle in the Republic of Panama.
Well, the name ahi is a Central American Indian word meaning hot pepper. It also in Japanese means flavor enhancer. And since this was the typical name that the pepper was known as, I went ahead and added the origin of Panama and my grandfather's nickname, Peppa, and call it Ahi Panama Pepper Peppa Sauce.
Okay, nice name and label, Larry, but what's Ahi Peppa Sauce got that the others don't?
It's absolutely guaranteed not to cause lower tract distress like all of your other hot sauce products.
Don't know about lower tract distress, but it can cause mouth distress. Just what does Larry put in his sauce anyway?
The recipe, of course, is a secret.
Larry is super secretive about his sauce. He wouldn't let us videotape him adding ingredients for fear we'd discover his grandfather's recipe. However, he says he'd gladly reveal his secret to an investor with an adventurous spirit and $240,000 in his pocket. So far, Larry's sauce plans aren't exactly causing established hot sauce companies to close up shop.
I don't think that they're taking me serious. And that's good.
Hot sauce producers might beware. Larry is Scottish, and it was another Scotsman by the name of McElhaney who founded Tabasco. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Dothan. Seven new classrooms are going up at Pleasant Home School in Covington County. But that's not all that's new here. This year, they started a new tradition.
In the ninth grade, we have Cheryl Gardner. Would you please come forward, Cheryl?
Students in Covington County didn't get applause and letters for football, baseball, or basketball, but for grades. This year, the top two students in grades 8 through 12 were honored for their scholastic achievement with more than just A's. They also received letters. The Covington County School Board came up with the idea, and the principals did the honors.
I think it's an excellent idea. I think that anything that we can do to encourage pride in our schools, pride in the academic area, I think this is good for our students and for them to receive recognition and know that this is a good thing for them to be striving for.
All 485 Pleasant Home students from kindergartners to seniors assembled to hear who would win the emblems. It was kind of a miniature Academy Awards, where even the students who won the letters didn't know who would be chosen. The acceptance speeches were brilliant, but brief.
I was real happy that we could be honored for our achievements.
Happy, surprised.
Shocked.
And where will these Covington County Oscars be placed?
Probably hanging on my wall, or my mirror. Since I don't have a mirror, I'll probably just hang it up on bulletin board.
They are, after all, in high school. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Covington County. Montgomery's ironclad landmark, the Court Square Fountain, spouted water here for the past 99 years. And now it's gone. But not for long. The 17,000-pound fountain is now in several hundred pieces at Robinson Foundry in Alex City. Most of its 800 parts are being recast. Although the equipment's a bit more refined, the process used is essentially the same as it was to build the original. Scrap iron is melted at 2,700 degrees Fahrenheit. The molten iron is then poured into a sand mold, which is an exact duplicate of the original casting.
What we're doing is making a sand impression of a pattern, and that pattern will look exactly like the casting that you're making. You literally make a hollow sand mold into which molten iron is poured. After the mold is poured with molten iron, the sand is broken away and the casting is removed from the sand mold. The sand actually is destroyed, but the casting is taken out and then used.
The ornamental castings are then soldered onto the base. The fountain's figures, including Hebe, who graces the top tier, were recast in aluminum in the early 1970s and are still in good shape, so they won't be replaced.
We'll build the fountain completely in our shop, but it will be disassembled into probably about five or six major subcomponents, taken to the site in Court Square, and then offloaded with crane and then re-erected on site.
In June, the fountain should be back and pumping for at least another 99 years. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Alex City. All students from Auburn and Opelika schools were eligible to compete in the Olympics of the Mind. Four teams were formed to square off in Camelot, the long-term problem competition. Blindfolded team members dressed up as Camelot characters and were instructed to do prescribed good deeds. Guinevere was the only team member who could see, and she, or he, had to use a wordless language to talk the knights through specific tasks, such as pulling Excalibur from a stone or taking the fire out of a dragon. Some used ropes, others clanged pot lids. One team had an elaborate signal system, including a unique way to tell the knights to knock down the evils.
We couldn't think of anything else to signal to terminate the evil, the blues. So David Jenkins just suggested the old tongue between the lips sound.
So what does all this teach the kids anyway? Media specialist Chuck Tremaine, who judged the competition.
I think it forces the kids to think a problem through before actually, you know, being able to look at causes and effects, looking down the road to consequences of their actions, being able to follow directions. That's probably the worst problem I think kids have that I see is being able to follow directions.
Learned how to cooperate. That was a big thing. And how to get along with one another.
The winners here will compete in a regional competition in Dothan on April 7th. From there, it's on to state and then to nationals. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Auburn. Here are the contestants. primping for the first annual Miss Adams Nursing Home Beauty Pageant.
Went to town, about getting some shoes and some other things, and I've been looking forward to it.
Yeah, I've had lots of fun. Mm-hmm.
What all have y'all been doing?
Well, we've been trying to be pretty.
The 12 spring beauties walked and wheeled into the limelight. They were judged on their physical appearance in relation to age and the responses to questions.
Okay, the other question is, if you could do anything you wanted to do today, what would it be and why?
Well, I'd just like to go home. Is that what all I would like to do?
That's right.
Well, there is no place like home. And with that answer, Virgie Colquitt went on to win Miss Congeniality. Runner-ups in the beauty pageant were 64-year-old Annie Ruth Graves and 76-year-old Jesse Hearn.
The winner of the first Miss Adams Nursing Home pageant is contestant number 6, Mary Nell Holland.
Mary Nell Holland was born and reared in Alex City, but she waited until she was 69 before she entered her first beauty pageant, and she won. Mary Nell is one of 30 beauties who will compete in the Miss Alabama Nursing Home Pageant in Montgomery on May 8th. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Alex City.
He likes me, doesn't he?
It's hard to believe this lively little girl is suffering from cirrhosis of the liver. She doesn't have that jaundice look so many liver disease patients have, yet her doctor says someday she will. Last year, the whole town of Thomasville came together to raise money for her liver transplant. When the Megan Smith Fund Drive began last summer, the red ribbon became Megan's symbol. People wore red ribbons, tied them to trees in their yard, and put up signs. Since then, the ribbons have faded, but Megan's fund is still going strong.
Right now, the balance in the account is $305,871.26, which includes about $6,500 of interest that the account has earned since the first of the year. It's accruing interest at the rate of about $2,200 a month.
Nobody really imagined it would grow like this.
Megan's operation is assured because of the generosity of others. The Smiths realize that many parents are agonizing over how they'll be able to afford a $200,000 to $400,000 liver transplant for their child. So the Smiths have helped form a support group for parents of children suffering from liver disease. The organization plans to lobby for legislation requiring insurance companies and Medicaid to pay for liver transplants. Also, arrangements are now being discussed to see if the Megan Smith Fund will not only be able to pay for Megan's liver transplant, but that of another Alabama child as well. Meanwhile, the Smiths wait.
We're just thankful for every day that we have to wait because it means that she's not having to undergo a transplant.
Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Thomasville.
I told Grady when he called that I didn't know who would be there because those that were not dead had one foot in the grave and I didn't think there'd be very many there.
But 9 of the 26 members of the class of 24 did show up, and 3 who couldn't make the trip sent tapes.
Those who can't be there and those that are there, I think of each one with a warm and loving memory.
And 10 members of the class who are now deceased were remembered in spirit.
I still remember this class and all the members. We had lots of good times together.
Some of those good times included snipe hunting, playing GHS girls basketball in satin bloomers, and making fun of an elderly Latin and French teacher known to all as Granny Bangs.
We thought she was so old to be teaching school. Well, she may have been, Georgia, but she doesn't seem as old to me now as she did back then.
I have a photograph. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Butler County.
When I started, there was, I don't think anyone in Alabama was making paper. There were very, very few even in the South. There were a couple in South Florida and two or three maybe in North and South Carolina.
That was 10 years ago. Now paper making is a bona fide art medium. The University of Georgia teaches a class in it, and so does Lee Bain at T.R. Miller High School in Brewton. To make paper, an aluminum screen is put in a vat filled with cotton rag pulp, then placed on felt, and designs are added from other screens. The water is then squeezed out in a homemade press. When it dries, the artist has a picture. Another good thing about papermaking is if you don't like what you've done, you can just tear it up, put it into a blender, and start over. Torn up scraps of undesirable works are put in a blender with bleach or dye and reused to make other pictures. Not only is this recycling cost-effective, Lee says papermaking is an art form in itself and more creative than just painting shapes and colors on ready-made paper.
It's just a little more personal, doing a little more of it yourself, being complete control of the paper. In the last few years, I've advocated really that the paper is a medium within itself, that does not have to be any painting or print or anything else on it, that just the paper itself can be an art form.
Lisa Walsh, WSFA and, TV News, traveling through Brewton.
What do you see the future of this? Do you think it's growing?
When Reverend Anderson started his soup kitchen last fall, Selma's unemployment rate was one of the highest in the state at 20%. He's served 21,000 meals since then.
Someone says, well, the poor is going to be with us always. Fine. Well, if you aren't poor, what are you going to do to help those that are poor?
Reverend Anderson has a forceful personality and runs his soup kitchen with an iron hand. His motto is, be good, be nice, or be gone. Born into a family of 16 on welfare, Reverend Anderson says he decided young never to be on welfare again. It's a philosophy he preaches to his patrons.
Grow from dependence to independence. And I think we can do that. I think we can really, honestly, pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps. I don't think that's a philosophy. That's a reality.
In reality, Reverend Anderson says anyone can fall into bad times. And that's where the soup kitchen comes in. Young and old eat here. People like 63-year-old Celestia Harrison, who worked at odd jobs for close to 50 years, and says now he's too old for anybody to hire.
It helped me a whole lot, because if it wasn't for this, I'd be in bad shape in one way, because I couldn't pay my bills and pay my house rent, and I wouldn't have nowhere to stay. But the food is good for me. I enjoy it. If I didn't, I wouldn't even come in for it.
The meals are prepared by volunteers. The building is provided by the Fathers of St. Edmund, a Roman Catholic order. The utilities are paid by the city. Canned food is given by the Department of Agriculture. And the extras, like fresh vegetables and spices, well, Reverend Anderson says he gladly takes donations. One such donation has been the use of 15 acres of land in Dallas County. Reverend Anderson plans to grow vegetables and put a catfish pond here. Some of the labor will be provided by the people who eat in the soup kitchen. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Dallas County.
January 20th,
Carissa, Nikki, and I went to the Drug Awareness Conference at the Montgomery Civic Center, and we learned all about drugs and alcohol there.
We decided the different kids in the different schools should have some information on drugs because soon they're going to be getting up in junior high and drugs might be pretty bad out there.
So the three girls got together and put together an anti-drug and alcohol abuse program, which they've been putting on for their classmates, the fifth and sixth graders at Prattville Intermediate.
About marijuana, they don't tell you that marijuana has a lot of harmful effects on the body. Like it changes your thinking ability, you can't learn as fast and can't remember what you've learned. Plus, you lose a lot of
the girls give out the facts, they also try to find out how much their classmates know about drugs by asking questions.
Which age group has the highest percentage of drug abusers? 10 through 17, 18 through 25, 26 through 35, 36 through 60, 61 and over.
The answer, 18 to 25-year-olds are the biggest drug abusers. So far, the drug abuse program has been a hit with 12-year-olds.
I think it was a good program, made me learn about a lot of things I didn't know about drugs.
I hope I never do get involved with drugs myself, because after seeing this program today, I've learned what effects it will have on my body and to myself.
Only sick people need drugs.
For 6 years, Dr. Thomas Ingram has been superintendent of Tuscaloosa City Schools. It's a job he put on the line 2 years ago when he implemented a tough promotion policy for students, in which one out of every seven students were held back a year because they didn't pass scholastic standards.
In the first year, we experienced, about 1,071 students that were not promoted in our system in grades 1 through 8, with approximately 7,500 students at that level.
Irate parents who were told their children have to repeat a grade staged sit-ins and filed lawsuits against the school board. The school board won in court, but didn't win over the hearts of the parents, so local ministers decided to bridge the gap.
Being that this is what we have to work with, and we ought to take this and make the best of it, rather than come up with any negative reactions or demonstrations or sit-in or whatever.
Reverend Blackburn contacted first grade teacher Fannie Gray and in January 1983 began Project Help, an after-school program taught in and supported by local churches. Project Help was a huge success.
We served 265 students, and of those 265 students, 85% of those students participating in the program met minimum requirements for promotion.
This year, Project Help is financed by the school board. With a budget of $5,000, 185 students are tutored after school, and they no longer have to sit in church pews.
Two afternoons a week after school, seven of Tuscaloosa's elementary schools open up for Project Help and offer free remedial courses in reading and math.
The results of the grade promotion policy and Project Help have been astounding.
We are now, for the first time at each grade level, above the national average, and we think that's progress.
Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Tuscaloosa. Puddles the Beagle is the only real mother these 13 pups have ever known. The puppy's real mother, Lulu, who is Puddles' sister, suffered postpartum blues after delivering her 13 pups by cesarean section and had no desire to nurse her own puppies. Fortunately, just hours after the puppies were brought home, Puddles, who had delivered two litters before, decided to step in.
I'm not so sure that this one didn't want to raise them. For one, she was real sore from the incision, so she may not have particularly wanted them nursing over, but it was just the point that the other dog wouldn't let her have them back. She didn't want her to have them back. She thought they were hers.
In his 5 years of practice, Dr. Wells says he's never seen one dog completely take over the burden of motherhood for another. Although other veterinarians say they've had such cases, it is unusual for a dog to instantly produce enough milk for 13 puppies.
But see, Puddles had already cleaned them up and just took over just like they were her 13 puppies.
The puppies are now 5 weeks old. All survived with a little help from their natural mother and lots of loving care from Aunt Puddles.
Thanks to Dr. Wells, Lulu will never have puppies again, and Puddles won't have to worry about feeding them. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Valley Grand Community in Dallas County.
Willie Bell may be the only person alive whose main means of transportation is two ladder-back chairs. Crippled with polio at age 13, Willie says crutches are uncomfortable and he can't get any work done on his small farm in his wheelchair, which he calls his Cadillac, and he uses only to go to town in.
I can't do no work in my Cadillac. My limousine, I can't do no work in there. See, I can get out in a roll around, sport around, but feeding my hog, watering my hog, something like that, you know, a home, my garden. I can't do nothing like that and not in there.
Willie's a farmer, always has been, tends to his own crops and animals. He balances a wash tub on his legs filled with feed for his chickens and pigs.
You ready? You don't know?
He has no running water, and yes, that's just what you think it is. He gets his water from a well and washes his clothes on a scrub board. He's a happy man and believes many people aren't happy today because they're too materialistic.
But a lot of folk got a lot of it and got a lot of things, but they don't appreciate it. They're yet reaching out. They can't carry it with them. Say, no way, they can't carry it with them. Say, all that, thank God what they, you know, to God, appreciate it. And then, because I'm proud of what I got.
What Willie's got is a good outlook on life. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Franklin in Monroe County. In the summer of 1983, Ron Murphy of Lee County was clearing his property in Waverly when he picked up an extremely heavy rock about this size.
I knew it was strange just by the weight. I mean, it was about three or four times as heavy as it should have been for that size. I was kind of hoping it was gold, but I'd like to have had about 10 pounds worth of gold. But unfortunately, it was not that, but I think it was a significant find from what I understand from Dr. Cook.
Iron meteorites that are found and identified are not old geologically. They're young. They're no more than a few million years old to a few thousand.
What makes this particular meteorite different is that in addition to the brown outer ring of iron oxide and the gray inside made primarily of a nickel iron alloy, the Waverly iron, as it's now known, also contains the mineral troilite, which is rarely found on Earth. Dr. Roy Clark at the Smithsonian Institution says his preliminary tests show the Waverly iron probably crashed to Earth several hundred thousand years ago. Meteors are drawn to Earth by gravity. But there are two theories on how they originated.
One is that there was a planet between Mars and Jupiter that broke up, and the fragments are forever in orbit around the sun. The other idea is that this is debris that was left over from the formation of some of the planets, and really there was a planet that should have formed that did not form for some reason.
The Waverly iron didn't create an impact like the giant meteorite which formed the Beringer crater in Arizona, but Dr. Clark says because of the Waverly iron's strange metallic composition, its impact on science could be even greater. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News.
George Washington Carver became famous worldwide for his research with the sweet potato here. And now, 41 years after his death, 18 scientists at Tuskegee Institute are performing experiments on sweet potatoes to prepare us for the 21st century.
Sweet potatoes are being radiated and pumped with carbon dioxide. The U.S. Department of Energy has appropriated $310,000 to the Carver Foundation in Tuskegee, and the foundation is negotiating for another $200,000, all for experiments on sweet potatoes.
I think that the choice was a natural. If if we look at the history of this research unit at Tuskegee Institute, this is a unit that was established by Dr. George Washington Carver.
The proper amount of radiation has been found not only to make sweet potatoes sweeter, but also to stop sprout growth and to lengthen shelf life. But even more important are the experiments which could help prepare us for the greenhouse effect predicted by the National Academy of Sciences. Scientists at the Academy say the burning of fossil fuel is creating an overabundance of carbon dioxide, which is forcing the Earth's temperature to rise. Dr. P.K. Biswas, who is studying the effects of increased amounts of carbon dioxide on sweet potatoes.
The temperature goes up by 3 degrees by year 2100. That means the growing season will be much longer and much hotter summer. That will decrease the wheat production. It has been predicted that Alabama will grow oranges, and instead of peaches anymore, we'll have to go into orange. And Florida may not be able to grow anything at all because of the high temperature.
Dr. Biswas says in 90 days he should know whether or not Alabama farmers will be able to grow sweet potatoes in the year 2100. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Tuskegee. Royal Sausage Company outside of Troy is one of 15 sausage-making plants in Alabama. Royal makes country sausage. And just what makes sausage country? Well, federal regulations specify that country sausage must be made outside of any city limits. So country sausage could be made in New York State, for that matter, as long as it's made outside the city limits. But Curtis Capps of Royal Sausage says you can't get much more country than Pike County, Alabama. Curtis and his 18 employees make 20,000 pounds of pork sausage and 6,000 pounds of chicken sausage each week. Northerners prefer whole hog or fresh sausage, which is made of hams, loins, and shoulders, while Curtis says true Southerners will eat almost any kind of sausage as long as it's smoked.
Well, the ones in the South seem to eat more smoked sausage than the northern people. That's even true in Alabama. From Birmingham north into Alabama, there's a large fresh sausage sales, and South Alabama is larger in the smoked sausage.
Although Curtis only sells his sausage in Alabama right now, he'll begin selling throughout the Southeast in September and plans to double his production. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Troy. There's an old saying that boys never grow up. Their toys just get more expensive. That may be true about the 20 boys in the Central Alabama Model Railroad Club in Prattville.
It's entirely different from everyday problems. You get in here and you shut the real world out and get into the model railroad world.
Bob Clemens is a public accountant who's moonlighted as a model railroader for the past 14 years. The club started in 1968 with members dedicated to making their train empire as close to the real railroad as possible.
They're sitting up across the cabs there. They are the mainline engineers. Each one of them controls one train. Behind them, hidden where he cannot see the railroad, is our dispatcher.
The dispatcher operates a switchboard which keeps the trains from crashing and on schedule.
Are all those locomotives powered?
Bill, just one of them.
Just one? You've got a heck of a load.
While Central Alabama Railroad is run like Southern or Illinois Central, there are a few exceptions.
Except in some cases where we have some derailments and we have to use not a wrecker like the big one, but what we call the 050 switcher. We pick it up with our hand.
The train empire, each man has found his niche. Those electronically inclined do the miles of wiring. The artistic create and paint the scenery. Thousands of hours and quite a few dollars have gone into laying down these Central Alabama tracks.
I don't think any of us stopped to figure it out. And my wife said it might shock us if we did.
These guys believe it's money well spent on building a near-perfect world with towns named after themselves or their dogs. My favorite was the high-altitude town of Richland, which is described in the Model Railroad Tour Guide as a vacationer's paradise, with a splendid view of everything. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Richland. I mean, Prattville.
This plane is called an SNJ by Marines, a T-6 by Air Force pilots, and a Harvard by the British. But Floyd McGowan of Butler County just calls it his own.
Floyd started flying when he was 16. He's owned and flown many planes over the years, but his favorite is this 1945 Warbird, used to train fighter pilots during World War II and the Korean War. Floyd had joined the Marines in 1951, hoping to fly an SNJ, but it wasn't until after he left the service that his dream came true. See, the Marines had made Floyd an air traffic control officer, so the only time he was near an SNJ, someone else was piloting it. But all that changed in 1982. Floyd heard that a farmer near Camden had an old SNJ in his hay barn. Floyd drove down, pulled the hay out of the cockpit, and bought it on the spot. It hadn't been flown in 24 years, but after 10 months of restoration, the plane was airworthy.
Well, the airplane still has a lot of mystique to it. People generally either love it or hate it.
Of course, Floyd loves it. A professional aerobatic pilot, he says an SNJ is perfect for his stunts.
Good acrobatic flying is almost a sensual thing. Very much involves your total personality and your total concentration when you're doing it. In other words, it's not something that you get bored with if you are deeply interested in it.
So if you're in Butler County and see an old Warbird in the sky, it's not World War III, it's just an old warrior having the time of his life. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Chapman in Butler County. It's not odd to take a trip to Mexico, but it is odd to go by mule. Ron Pung left Ocala, Florida on May 10th with his dog Beer Break and his mule Miss Detox, so named because Ron says she has nerves of steel. When we caught up with Ron, he had a passenger, little Christy Parsons of Greenville, whose grandparents said she could ride a ways with his 51-year-old mule Skinner, who believes riding the back roads by mule is the only way to travel.
Be able to smell the flowers, see the trees and hear the birds sing as you go along is really, really great. It's relaxing in this fast pace that everyone is in today. It's great to be able to get out and slow down and enjoy life and see the things that we miss so much by car and truck and fast travel.
Ron says the people he meets make his trip most enjoyable. Some think he's crazy.
How far is he riding?
To Mexico.
Oh, it is hilarious.
Others want to join him.
Meet a lot of people.
See a lot. Meet a lot of people. It'd be an enjoyable ride. Might need a bath when we get there, but we'd take a shot.
The reason he passes through Greenville on his way from Florida to Mexico is to avoid the big towns, long bridges, and heavy traffic of the more direct route. A retired truck driver, Ron says truck driving is nothing like mule driving.
Vast difference. When you're in that truck, you're under pressure all the time. You got to be someplace at a certain time, and you pick up a load or drop a load, and you don't get a chance to enjoy life in a truck.
Another good reason to travel by mule is that you can trot by the gas pumps. Because Miss Detox fills up on 10 pounds of oats and grazes for free the rest of the day. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Greenville. Dr. Wolfgang Birch is a chemist from Germany, and Jeff Brill is an entomologist from South Africa. Both have joined forces at the University of Alabama to help farmers in their fight against fire ants.
It usually affects cattle, usually don't graze anywhere near the mounds. And the other thing that they've reported problems with is when farmers are plowing their fields, usually the mounds will clog up the plowshares, And when the farmer comes to clean them off, he gets fire ants all over his body, and they sting him all over.
It's rare when someone dies from ant stings, but possible if the victim is allergic to the ant poison. Pesticides now used to get rid of fire ants kill not only the ants, but many other insects which aren't harmful but helpful to the farmer. So scientists are trying to develop a selective process to eradicate the ants. Birch and Brill are studying pheromones, the chemical substances ants emit.
If you know what the pheromone is, the chemical that the ants are using to lay their trail, what you can do is lay a false trail, say to a bait that's poisoned or something like that, and then what you'll do is you'll induce all the ants, all the foraging ants, to come to that instead of the food, and eventually, hopefully, the colony will starve.
Jeff goes out once a month to replenish the supply of fire ants, which are plentiful in nearby Tuscaloosa and Pickens counties. Ants of one colony act in an orderly fashion and don't fight because they are able to recognize each other by their pheromones. But as soon as ants from different colonies with different pheromones are placed together, they immediately attack and kill each other. Someday, Birch and Brill's research may be used to help develop a synthetic pheromone, which could be potent ammunition for farmers in their battle against fire ants. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, Tuscaloosa. For the past 36 years in Cottonwood, Pauline's is the place to be. Of course, there's not much else in Cottonwood. It's dinner time in Cottonwood. Time for the regulars to start coming into Pauline's. There's Reverend B.W. West, one-time Baptist preacher, now nicknamed Speedy. He likes to amble by and find out who's catching what and where. Of course, everybody has reasons for coming here.
I especially like the fried chicken and vegetables.
Cottonwood is my home, and grown up with Pauline's.
I just feel fine when I come in here because they give me a smile and they act like they want to wait on me. So that makes all of the difference as far as I'm concerned.
Good food and entertainment. Hear all the latest news.
Oh yeah, that's the most fun part. That's why everybody comes here, to find out what everybody else is doing.
The customers are what make Pauline's Ask Pauline. Her Cottonwood customers have given her 736 sets of salt and pepper shakers, which she proudly displays on a wall in her city cafe.
I always wanted to collect something, and this cousin of mine sent me a set from Cedar Rapids, Iowa. And I said, well, that would be what I'd collect.
As good a reason as any, but it's 1 o'clock on Wednesday, closing time in Cottonwood. Of course, everybody will be back tomorrow, because everybody knows if you don't show up, you'll most likely be the topic of conversation at Pauline's. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Cottonwood. Since the Chinese invented firecrackers 2,000 years ago to scare off evil spirits each New Year, fireworks have become a part of major celebrations. Here in the U.S., July 4th is the big day. 90% of all fireworks sold in this country are bought to shoot off during Independence Day celebrations. Tomorrow, fireworks will be bursting in the air all over Alabama, including 1,100 pounds of fireworks, which will be shot off an island on Lake Martin directly across from Winton Blunt's lake home near Kalijah Marina. The show will last a half hour, beginning with a 56-shot opening number and a 400-shot finale. Yesterday and today, pyrotechnic operators set up the mortars and finale racks for tomorrow's bombardment. This 6-foot mortar is the tallest they'll use to put a shell in the air. Fireworks operate similar to guns. The longer the barrel, the further the shot will go. For the past 11 years, Dave Evans of Newcastle, Pennsylvania, has fired off shows around the country and says it's never boring when you have 700 shells with 90-second fuses. And although he hears the shows, he hasn't seen one in years.
I haven't seen fireworks in 11 years. When you're firing, you can't watch them.
Oh, why not?
You have to be loading the next bomb when the one you just fired is on the way up in the air.
The show starts tomorrow night at 9. Everyone's invited to come by car or boat. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, Lake Martin. It's hard to believe that a barn in the middle of 7 acres of cropland in Fair Nelson in Kanaka County would be the site of a thriving business, but it is. Katie Burt started 2 years ago with the yard sale and liked it so much she decided to go into it full time. She now has 3,000 square feet of everything. At Katie's, people can pay cash, put it on layaway, or make a trade. The day we were there, a lady from nearby Burnt Corn brought in some old clothes and drove off with a mattress and box springs. Katie's far-flung array of items provides a veritable paradise for kids.
Oh, what a big girlfriend.
And her confirmed customers are walking advertisements for the place.
Stop by almost every day.
Yep.
And to check and see, especially for the children's clothes. And, it's just amazing how you can save it. Katie's Bargain Barn.
Collectors come to Katie's to get those hard-to-find items.
We have several. People coming from everywhere hunting different kind of bottles. The old milk and magnesia bottles are not made anymore, the blue ones. Mm-hmm. So that's a collector's items.
About this time of year, bottles aren't the big sellers, but purple hull peas are. And after Katie's customers purchase a pound of peas for 35 cents, they can sit out back and shell them. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Fair Nelson in Kanaka County. For the past 10 years, John Freeman of Lafayette has lived here at the Veterans Medical Center in Tuskegee.
John Freeman is a very unique individual. I have known him for 6 years. He's the type of person that you grow to love. When you're down in the dumps, he's a good person to come talk to. He can motivate you.
I am so happy, I don't know what to do. I'm ecstatic. Just being here and being able to do what I can do.
Many might wonder what John has to be happy about. He's a quadriplegic. Once an active New York City policeman, he now is paralyzed from the neck down.
The main thing, I guess, that motivates me is other people. As I said before, I'm a people person.
John likes people and they like him back. He has pen pals all over Alabama who keep his spirits up. People like Terrence Smith of Bruton, who wrote, "Dear Mr. Freeman, this was a very happy year for me at Southern Normal School. I hope you have a very fine time in the hospital. Love, Terrence." John has a fine time. Although his body is powerless, his mind is powerful. He writes letters and poetry by memorizing what he wants to say and then dictating it to a friend.
I'll never forget those magic moments.
John's become somewhat of the sage of Ward 62-1. He always takes time to listen to problems and give advice.
Whatever you can do, be the best at it.
Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Tuskegee. In 1854, Matthew Brunson built this log cabin near the banks of Pea River, close to a community which is now called Enterprise. It's since been restored by Walter and Ellen Lunsford of Enterprise, who made it into a needlecraft shop. The Lunsfords were attracted to the home because of its solid structure and charm. The house is built of cypress, with logs up to 38 feet long. The walls are made of the original hewn logs, which are pegged together.
Well, of course, the logs were put together when they were green, and then they would use dry pegs and drive them in as tight as they could. And then when the green logs cured, they would shrink and tighten the pegs in the holes. And that's why they're in so tight. I'm sure that if these logs could talk, they could tell us about peanut shellings and candy makings and dances they used to have here.
The floorboards would probably tell us that they strained enough under the weight of their former owner. Matthew Brunson weighed 365 pounds, or as he put it, a pound for every day of the year. Matthew was a bit eccentric. He had a deep and abiding horror of being buried below the ground, so he built a burial chamber here in the attic. After he died, his family lived up to his wishes and buried him here, for 10 days anyway. After 10 days, the family moved him out of the house and into nearby Woodland Grove Cemetery. As he requested, they kept his body preserved in formaldehyde in a glass casket and did bury him above the ground, New Orleans style anyway, although he's probably not at all pleased to find himself slowly sinking beneath the ground. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Coffee County. John Vleck, the clockmaker of Ozark, was stationed in Germany in the 50s. It was there that his love affair with clocks began.
Private in Germany, with nothing to do, followed a blonde home and found that her father's clocks were more interesting than she was.
John served an apprenticeship with a clockmaker in Germany for 7 years and then became a master. For years, clocks were just a hobby, but when he retired as an aviation contractor at Fort Rucker in Ozark, he went into clocks full time. Unfortunately, John is one of a dying breed.
Can't get the younger people to get involved in it and devote 3 to 5 years of their life just learning how to fix the clock when they can learn how in 3 months, as far as they're concerned, and go down the corner and open up a shop.
Luckily, John has found an able apprentice in Paul Antoniak, a 23-year-old Polish immigrant who has apprenticed with John for the past 2 years. Rebuilding aviation clocks for Fort Rucker's helicopter fleet is the bread and butter for this clockmaker and his apprentice, but both prefer working on antique clocks, preferably turn-of-the-century German-made. But what about Rolex?
If you want a status symbol, then it's an extremely good buy.
And what does this master clockmaker wear on his wrist? A battery-operated Pulsar. He says he can make them and fix them, but he can't remember to wind them. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Ozark. The East Alabama Medical Center in Opelika won't have its $10 million expansion finished until December, but they've already started their sibling preparation classes. Nurse Colleen Alsobrook gives the children and their parents a tour of the maternity ward so they'll know exactly where mama and baby will be when they're in the hospital. Then the kids are taught the fine art of diapering and brush up on burping and feeding.
I learned that how to change a diaper and feed a baby doll.
Nurse Alsobrook also tries to show the children that the hospital isn't such a bad place after all, and most importantly, make them understand why mother must go into the hospital to have the baby.
We just gone through it with my sister-in-law, and they have a child that's the same age as Daniel, and she couldn't understand why mama couldn't come home, and so I'm trying to get him briefed for that.
The children are also briefed on what daddy will wear if he decides to stay in the delivery room. For some, that's the best part of the course.
And we dressed up.
You think you're gonna
be able... I really like those uniforms.
The sibling preparation class is free, last an hour and a half, and will be taught again in September. By then, most of these children will have a baby brother or sister at home. Of course, some already know what they want.
The girl.
Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Opelika. At this training center in Randolph County, Christian workers are taught appropriate technology. From here, they'll go all over the world practicing what they call practical Christianity.
Help people meet their basic human needs at the same time. They learn the motivations of why they're living or what they're living for.
CFAT stands for Servants in Faith and Technology. It was founded in 1979 by Ken Corson and his wife Sarah in her hometown of Wadawa. Funded primarily by Methodist churches in Alabama, CFAT with a staff of 18 prepares Christian workers for third world countries by teaching them appropriate technology, such as intensive gardening or how to use windmill power to irrigate fields.
Here we go. Are y'all ready?
People with widely differing backgrounds come to CFAT. Nino Kumbo is a 14-year-old from New Jersey. He's interested in becoming a missionary and came to CFAT to see if he's cut out for that lifestyle. For the past 9 days, he's worked the fields, bathed in a creek, and lived in a tent.
Living in tents that leak, I mean, that's how most of the world lives. Mm-hmm. Not in houses where you can turn on water, but like walking miles to get water and working hard for your food.
While Nino is a boy deciding what to do with his life, others like Samuel Mayers of Sierra Leone, Africa,
the activities of the church. And I believe that having training at CFAT, I'll be able to meet the needs of my people in Africa, both spiritually as well as technologically.
David Brookbank of Washington State has just returned from 4 weeks in Nicaragua. He plans to return after completing the 9-week CFAT course.
People will resort to some means of changing their lives, and it often could be violent unless they have some kind of alternative. So I think it's important for those who have skills and abilities to share them rather than to hoard them.
David hopes to stem violence by teaching people how to meet their basic needs. As with all the other people who live and learn at CFAT, he believes people can't absorb Christian theology on an empty stomach. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Wadawi in Randolph County. Alfie Dow and Alan Cormack normally fight fires in Aberdeen, Scotland, but this week they're keeping blazes under control in Alex City, like at this practice drill. The Scottish firefighters met two Alex City residents at Disney World last year, and this year decided to spend their vacation in Alex City, answering fire calls, or shouts as they say in Scotland. Alfie and Alan have shorter work weeks in Scotland and make less money than their Alex City counterparts. However, unlike Alex City firefighters, neither Alfie nor Alan are paramedics. Although the equipment and salaries are different in Scotland, Alan says firefighters in Aberdeen, Scotland and Alex City, Alabama are the same.
They're exactly the same. They all seem to like a laugh and a carry on. Everybody gets on well together. I think that makes part of the job.
But Alfie and Alan haven't spent their whole vacation putting out fires. They've gone skiing on Lake Martin.
I would like it if I could stand up.
And they were treated to a banquet in their honor featuring barbecue chicken. It was easy to spot Alfie and Alan at the banquet. They ate their first barbecue chicken Scottish style with a knife and fork. Lisa Walsh, WSFA TV News, traveling through Alex City.